Nearly 150 million. 1 month's tax from BP for North Sea Oil.
I hope they enjoy it.
Thank you.
But as oil prices fall and the Chancellor looks to the budget, TVI looks to the long term, commissioning a survey to find out what will happen to the economy when the oil runs out.
The North Sea, Britain's offshore oil field. Wealth for the country, income for the government. But its value is falling because of worldwide surplus. Here at BP's headquarters, they have to wrestle with the tumbling oil price. Today, it's $15 a barrel.
If the Germans cut and the Japanese cut and then the Americans don't, we're going to see this dollar bounce quite a bit, you know?
4 months ago, it would have cost you $30. The collapse has shaken all the major oil-producing countries. The immediate effect of the falling oil price has been to cut the Chancellor's revenues and give him a headache over his budget sums. In the longer term, it's made the question of how Britain is going to cope as the oil runs out seem more urgent. In Cambridge, TVI asked economist Professor Wynne Godley to consider the effect of falling oil production and revenue on the economy. He's often been condemned as alarmist, but his record is impressive. 9 years ago, he predicted we'd now have 3 million unemployed. TVI asked him to look forward to 1995, the year when we ceased to export oil, and his forecast was no less dramatic. He predicted that without the oil money, we'd face either a balance of payments crisis or unemployment running up to 5 million, unless there's a dramatic change of policy.
I think it's a problem of absolutely staggering magnitude. Either we have unemployment rising substantially by a further amount, or we have large devaluation and accelerated inflation, or some dreadful combination of.
Every month at BP's headquarters in London, they pay over the government's share of their North Sea earnings.
Hello, Jeanette. What have we got here?
It's the PRT check for signing for this month.
Is it a big one?
Yes, it is. 149
million. 149
million.
Well, that's not much.
This month's petroleum revenue tax check is for nearly £150 million. Apart from the benefits of exports, the government has had over £50 billion in direct revenue from the oil companies. So where has it all gone?
There we are. Over to you. I hope they enjoy it.
Thank you.
We've used the oil money by enabling interest rates to be lower than they would otherwise be, taxes to be lower than they would otherwise be, and expenditure on everything from defence, law and order, social security, housing and roads to be higher than they would otherwise be. We've not set up a specific fund, but it would be a great illusion to believe that because we haven't done that, we have not obtained very substantial benefits from that oil.
We should have had a big fund, as we began to do under the last government, to put money into industry, to re-equip our old industries, to move into new industries, to provide opportunities for improving the infrastructure, to have improved education and so on. Instead of that, we just used it simply to cover a balance of payments problem and allow our industry to be destroyed. I mean, I think it is the greatest act of treachery to the national interest in 20th century history that this should have happened and people have not yet woken up to what has happened, and when they do, they'll realise we're going to have a very big job recovering from it.
Sullom Voe in the Shetlands, where the oil comes ashore. Critics argue that the massive flow of revenue hasn't been used to benefit our economy. Instead, the oil money has disguised the fact that the economy is in decline, with manufacturing output lower than it was during the three-day week, unemployment at record levels, and our share of world trade falling.
The truth is that the underlying problem of the British economy has been getting worse for decades. Things were reaching ahead, actually, just before the oil came on stream. And without oil, we would have had to face up to the problems. As it is, the government's been able to avoid facing up to the problems.
One man who's done well out of the oil years is millionaire Stan Hales. His warehouse is located in the heart of the West Midlands.
I came out of that company in Starbridge. It closed down a couple of years ago.
Yes, I think I remember. But you forget these things after a bit, of course. But yes.
As the manufacturing companies around him have closed down, he's made his fortune buying up their machinery and selling it abroad.
Well, this has come up well, hasn't it?
Made a nice job of it.
They have. Oh. Actually, you know, in ordinary times, there'd be so many customers wanting to buy that, you wouldn't be able to get in here for people.
It'll be quite presentable, that machine again.
Yes, well, it looks good now. Yeah. When it's just finalised, it'll be
super.
You know,
the Koreans may be interested in that as well. We did sell one there.
When I first came into this business in 1960, it was only the rubbish that went abroad, mainly to Italy. But all the usable and good machinery was stayed in this country. In general, there were exceptions, but that's generally the case. Particularly, of course, the big machinery, which is irreplaceable, more or less, that all certainly stayed in this country. Now it almost, without exception, goes abroad.
As a rolling mill from a Herefordshire factory is crated off to China, the argument is that companies were forced out of business by the way North Sea oil was used. That the government allowed oil to push up the value of the pound to a level at which our exports became too expensive for foreigners to buy, while foreign imports became too cheap for us to resist.
In part, I think it was inevitable. North Sea oil, the coming on stream of North Sea oil, meant that the UK had to devote less manufacturers to pay for oil energy, oil or energy imports in general. And this simply meant that, certainly as a share of our GDP, manufacturing had to fall. Then, of course, this coincided with a very substantial rise in the price of oil, which meant that other countries had to devote more manufacturers to pay for their oil, so that added really to, in a combined sort of way, reducing the necessity, if you like, the need for the UK to sell manufacturers to pay for oil.
So are you saying then that manufacturing had to contract when North Sea oil came on stream?
I suspect it did, simply because the rest of the world, within a year or two after the 79-80 rise in the price of oil, began to contract. And if we agreed that the UK share in the world total of manufacturers had to decline somewhat, then I think in the context of a fall in the total production of manufacturers, some fall in UK manufacturing production was inevitable.
North Sea oil doesn't all belong to Britain. The oil fields are shared with Norway, the other place where the theory that the oil revenue must damage industry could be tested. Stavanger is the oil capital of Norway, but the jobs generated by the building of huge oil platforms mirror high employment levels across the economy. The most striking difference between Britain and Norway is that with our unemployment at 13%, theirs is running at less than 2%. The Norwegian government has put massive investment into Norwegian industry. Last year, they handed out £600 million, proportionately three times as much as our government puts into our industry. They're now the second most prosperous nation in Europe, and their experience has been the opposite of ours. Manufacturing production has grown since they got the oil. Now it's actually growing faster than the oil sector.
We are now in a good way of growth in the industry production, in the manufacturing production in 85 and 84 and 86, and that's something new. In the 70s we didn't have any growth, but now we're into a time when we are having growth more years in a row, and we are now on a higher level than we were back in the middle of the 70s.
Robertson Tritech is the kind of company that's been helped by the Norwegian government's readiness to invest in industry. The company employed 140 people, making navigational equipment for ships. But its traditional markets were declining, and it was only by means of a £500,000 loan from the government that it was able to develop the new product it needed to survive.
When I came into the company in 1982, we faced a difficult situation. The company relied almost 100% on two marine markets, the shipping market and the fishing market, which both really had a bleak future. And on top of that, we had products that were coming fairly close to the end of their lifetime. And we had to do two things, both to find ways of developing new products and to find new market segments for them.
Was there a real chance at that time that the company might go out of business?
Yes, I would say so.
The company's survival has allowed it to develop new high-tech products like this underwater remote camera. It can be used to photograph offshore platforms or take part in undersea searches. Robertson Tritech's story emphasises the importance that all Norwegian governments give to full employment. In power at present is a conservative-led coalition.
That has been our main goal, to be able to have full employment. And, for example, I myself, representing the Conservative Party in Norway, has this as the absolutely main goal. And that also means that we have been using oil money to put people into work.
How important is the commitment to full employment?
It's very important. I would say it's the most important goal in the Norwegian society today, and it's all parties has that as the number one.
We took evidence, and the evidence supported every single thing that we said, even that sharp warning that you have referred to. And it's not as if we said there is a crisis today. There isn't. There would be if we hadn't got oil, as we have. Oil gives us a little time. The danger is that people don't understand how serious things will be when the oil's gone if we don't do something about manufacturing.
Professor Godley's survey supported Lord Aldington's view. Using a computer model of the economy, he concluded that while oil had made the problems of British industry worse, it had not itself caused those problems, and that the oil revenue hit a deep-rooted trend. Over the years, Britain's manufacturing exports have risen steadily. But the problem is that imports have risen twice as fast, until in 1983 the two crossed over, and we went into deficit on manufactures for the first time.
The simple continuation of the past trends meant that after 1977, the relationship between exports and imports deteriorated, and the two crossed over sometime about 1982 or 1983, and we're now in deficit. And the trends were established before oil came on stream, and they're going to continue as it comes to an end.
Today, Britain's economy is being kept afloat by oil. It's providing an £8 billion surplus to our balance of payments. Services like banking and tourism add another £6 billion a year, with another so-called invisible export, overseas investment, providing £3 billion more. But the problem lies with manufacturing. There's a £3 billion deficit, giving us an overall surplus of £5 billion when other items are included. But what of the future?
The deficit in the balance of trade and manufactures, so far from getting better, will actually get very much worse. I estimate that it will get, I mean, these are taking point estimates, of course, and over a long period of time, that it will deteriorate to about 20 billions by the mid-1990s.
This is how Wynne Godley sees the balance of payments in 1995. The oil surplus will have disappeared. So although invisibles like banking still do well, with the surplus on services up to £10 billion and income from overseas investment still at £3 billion, both are dwarfed by the £23 billion manufacturing deficit. So we're left £20 billion in deficit, with all other items included.
If the government were to respond to the emerging balance of payments deficit by deflation, then it would have to cut output probably about 12% still further below trend. And that in turn would cause unemployment to rise between 1 and 2 million more, to something like 5 million in 1995.
I don't think one is in a position to make a prediction of that kind. I mean, take, for example, the question of manufacturing industry. Already, the London Business School, this year, just very recently, has come up with a prediction very much more optimistic than that contained in the House of Lords report. And that illustrates that these things move, and they move really rather fast. And therefore, to say today that in the 1990s, in the mid-1990s, this, that or the other prediction of gloom is going to come about, with due respect to those responsible for making that prediction, doesn't seem to me to be something that should cast a gloom in us today.
This more optimistic view of Britain's prospects was forcibly expressed to the House of Lords Committee by Chancellor Nigel Lawson. He said that the service industries might provide valuable invisible earnings to help fill the oil gap.
If it does turn out that we are relatively more efficient in world terms at providing services than at producing goods, then our national interest lies in a surplus on services and a deficit on goods.
The kind of process he's talking about can be seen here at Dudley in the West Midlands. The closure of this steelworks cost 2,500 jobs in manufacturing. But on the same site, new service industries, in this case shops, are opening up. Britain is regarded as highly efficient in services, and some, like banking, insurance and tourism, contribute substantially to our invisible earnings. The other contributor to invisible earnings is overseas investment.
As a result of the oil, we have been able to invest overseas huge sums of money, vast British investments overseas, which weren't dreamt of before, which are providing us a stream of income and will continue to do so as the take from the North Sea diminishes. And that's a very substantial, solid and future factor which will stand us in very good stead.
Well, I think it is entirely fantastic. There can be a growth of services of, an optimistic estimate would be 3 billion. The idea that services can fill the gap completely falls down on magnitudes. And exactly the same thing applies to the income from investments abroad. I mean, the net property income from abroad is currently around 3 billion a year. Now, if we're going to have a zero balance or balance of payments deficit, that isn't going to grow very much. I mean, it could possibly grow 1 or 2 billion. But services, transfers, and property income from abroad are completely dwarfed by the deficit arising on oil and manufacturing.
In its reply to the House of Lords Committee, the government put another crucial argument. Industry in the oil years has got leaner and fitter.
The whole thrust of government policy since 1979 has been designed to reverse the long-standing deterioration in the competitiveness of the UK economy and to create the conditions in which enterprise and initiative can flourish.
There is no question, the figures suggest, that manufacturing capacity has been reduced, but I suspect the large amount of capacity that's gone that wasn't very economic anyway and couldn't survive in the long run. I think we've got plenty of evidence to suggest that what survives is much leaner and much fitter. And provided we can maintain the competitiveness, the extra competitiveness that we've got just in the last few weeks, really, by the fall in the real exchange rate, the prospects for growth is quite good.
Leaner, yes. Fitter, no. Investment has been so low that manufacturing has actually less equipment now than it did in 1979. Our exports of manufacturers are at an all-time low when expressed as a share of world trade. Our imports of manufacturers are at an all-time high. Our competitiveness has deteriorated compared with 1979.
The House of Lords Committee were told about one company that's undeniably fit. Rolls-Royce Motors still claims to make the best car in the world and still exports 2 out of every 3 it makes. But during the years we've had oil, they were told the Rolls-Royce has become a little less British, as the company has had to increase the amount of foreign components it buys by 50%. This alternator is made in France. Until 2 years ago, Rolls-Royce fitted British alternators.
We used to fit a British alternator, and quite simply, we ran out of capacity. And as the electrical load of all the extra equipment on the car grew, we found that we had to uprate it from 55 to 70 amps. Finally, we ran out of capacity, and we buy the French alternator to go to 90 amps.
Who was the British one made by?
By Lucas CAV.
And could they not make one to meet the new specification that you had in mind?
No, there was not an alternator suitable for this particular installation.
Beneath the Rolls-Royce dashboard, a British radio has been replaced with one from Germany. But some economists argue that the shakeout in British industry had to happen, and that oil has made a useful contribution in seeing us safely through this painful time.
I suspect North Sea Oil did provide that breathing space to bring about really quite substantial structural changes in British industry, which were clearly manifest in the 1970s, as other economists are willing to acknowledge. But you cannot bring about substantial structural changes of this character, raising the productivity per unit of labour and capital, without causing some problems and maybe misery elsewhere in the economy.
But having heard the arguments, the House of Lords committee decided there was a danger that...
As the oil revenues diminish, the country will experience adverse effects which will worsen with time. Failure to recognise these dangers now could have a devastating effect on the future economic and political stability of the nation.
I'm afraid after cross-examining them, we don't agree with them. That's what we came to. We think that manufacturing industry does not recover automatically. It's got to rebuild itself, it's got to make great investments, it's got to develop new products, sometimes taking 10 years or so.
By 1995, it seems clear that Britain will no longer export oil. The task will be to provide enough for our own needs. We'll be left to earn a living in the world without the North Sea bonus. So what will historians say? Did we use or squander the oil?
They will say that at a time when the rest of British industry had become to a deeply depressing extent uncompetitive, and when the world recession was facing us, we were able to weather the storm in a way which was uncomfortable, but might have been very, very much more uncomfortable because of the skill with which the North Sea was exploited.
Having completed your study for us, do you believe that the oil money has been wasted?
It's been worse than wasted. It could have been used to sustain output where other countries couldn't, thereby generating investment and making the economy stronger in all kinds of different ways. What has actually happened is that we've had the worst recession since the war. We've had the exchange rate higher than it otherwise would have been, and therefore our competitive position and our trading performance is actually worse now than it would have been if we'd never had oil.